kind of have many hats as far as what I do and what I kind of do now and what I used to do. I guess now I'd be called a 3D generalist, a digital sculptor, an audiovisual performer, and I'm also an animator. Those are a lot of buzzwords, but let's kind of get into what I do. When I was in college, I actually studied under Nathaniel Stern, who Scott was a collaborator with. He was kind of a big mentor and guidance to what I did in school, and I studied a lot of this kind of software. And I came from a background of, I was a computer science major, learning C++ and things like that, but I kind of, once I learned that you could do more creative things with code, I got a lot more excited about this kind of stuff, and I started learning things like MaxMSP and processing and Pure Data and Arduino. And he had Zach Lieberman come and talk to us about Open Frameworks and his iWriter project when it kind of came out, and that was a really eye-opening experience for me, pun intended. But the main thing that I loved about all that stuff was I learned how generative systems and things like that interact with one another, and what really excited me about that was that I could kind of recreate that kind of stuff in 3D environments, because once I learned about rendering engines and how to create realistic lighting and texturing inside of a 3D environment, coding at the time was not doing it for me, because no one was really showing me how to do this kind of 3D, advanced 3D stuff in a coding environment. So I kind of moved on to learning things like Maya and After Effects and Cinema 4D. What's up, 3D? Yeah. So with that kind of stuff, it kind of transitioned into learning a lot more 3D and moving on to other projects. But what I got really excited about in school in my senior projects, this is some old school work of mine, was projection mapping. And at the time, this is before like MadMapper and things like that existed. And so these are really crude max patches I wrote to basically try to mask something onto these shapes. And I come from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. I moved here about 2 years ago. And so in Milwaukee, there was not a lot of people encouraging this kind of stuff or really kind of into it at all or knowledgeable in the subject, except for Nathaniel when he was showing me a lot of like the anti-VJ collective out of Europe and people like Kit Webster and stuff that were doing these really awesome installations with projection mapping at the time. And so it kind of inspired me to do a lot more of that. And I kind of got really into particle systems and exploring generative motions, but done in code, or not in code, but taking it to 3D. So this right here is a kind of a funny joke. This was the first thing I ever rendered out of a 3D application, and it actually landed me in my first official music video I ever did right out of college. I found out the artist actually, I sent him a bunch of material to show this record label to prove that I could do this video, and he showed him a 4-second clip called testrender1.mov. And I kind of freaked out, but they called me back the next day and said they wanted me to do this music video in this kind of 3D lo-fi style, I guess, like this low geometric, low polygonal style. And I ended up making this video called Gorbour, which debuted on Plant Music. And I have a hard time watching this now because it's really old and bad to me. But this video kind of kickstarted a lot of my kind of art career, I guess you want to call it. This was one of the first things I ever did right out of school, and it was the artist is also has his master's from Yale in painting and color theory and is an abstract minimalist painter, so he kind of designed this room and this whole concept for this piece and needed me to kind of animate it for him. And he was very involved in the process, sitting over my shoulder in a lot of ways and kind of guiding me through like what this room was going to be looking like. And it's kind of got a lot of creation and destruction in this piece. We're not going to watch the whole thing just because you guys are hanging out late. It's all on my website, you can check it out. But what was cool about this video is that it got a lot of international attention, and it was featured at the Volt Music Festival in Stockholm, Sweden, where they played it at this amazing, I'm not going to pronounce the name because I'll butcher it, but this amazing Congress theater where they had a screening for people like Amon Tobin, Bjork, Flying Lotus, people that I'm super inspired by, that they decided to play my film along with those as some of their favorites of the year. Shortly thereafter, IDN Worldwide Magazine out of Hong Kong picked it up as their best of 2011 on their DVD and gave me an awesome feature, which was very, very nice of them. And so that kind of got me a lot of people contacting me about stuff. Once this happened, I decided to really take 3D and my kind of art and animation a little bit more seriously and get really into learning as much as I could about this, because this was a huge learning experience for me on this project. So I started an everyday project where I created a new piece of art every day for a year. That was really heavily inspired by my buddy Mike, who you guys know as Beeple, probably. He's a very huge animator and also fellow Wisconsin native. And so he kind of really encouraged me to learn. The best way you can learn is by just doing something every day. I highly encourage anyone here that is in a creative rut or of any kind wants to learn some new software to just dive into doing something. These took me about 45 minutes to an hour a day where I was spending after work, usually late at night, creating something. And the subject matter changed quite often. Most of it was learning experiences, trying new techniques, things like that. But I probably got more freelance offers during this year than any other time I've ever done art. And I had so many people contacting me about stuff, and it was awesome. And most of these turned into actual projects or videos later on. Just some more stuff from that. The top left became like an album cover for someone. The bottom right was actually some animations I was working on for an artist in Milwaukee for a performance they were doing, and you know, all sorts of things. But I it's a really great way to just pull ideas out. You know, there was a lot of crappy ones too. I'm showing you some nicer ones. But yeah, so that led me to making more music videos. And the top left was one for Alec Carlson out of France. Top right was for Ernest Blunt in LA. And then the bottom one is someone I'm working with now a lot more, which we'll get into later, which was with a collaboration with a filmmaker for Riot, for Brainfeeder. And I kind of, you know, I got a lot of people wanting me to do these animations and these full-length music videos for them. And I kind of like doing that, but this doing all these other videos kind of taught me that I was more excited about presenting my visuals in a way that was kind of outside of just looking at a screen and looking at your computer or like looking at it on a projection screen. So I really was going back to what I was doing in school, where I was really excited about exploring other spaces and how you could project art in different ways. And that got me really excited about doing kind of more projects. And so what I want to show you now is kind of a really quick reel. It's a couple minutes long, but it's got some music, it's cool. and it's of some of my more current stuff, and I'll kind of get into like more of my current process and see what that's looking like. So we'll watch this. We'll be right back. So yeah, this is some more recent animation stuff, and I kind of want to get into how code has kind of influenced this kind of stuff. Since I come from a background of learning this kind of procedural way of making things in a very technical manner, and I'm a very technical person, I kind of set up a bunch of ground rules when I animate, and it's kind of a weird process, and I would be super inspired if other people kind of thought this way, and I would love to hear if other people think this way. But when I kind of animate stuff, I'm not a traditional person where I'm sitting there keyframing kind of each individual thing. I like to set up environments and I like to explore them in a 3D software or in things like After Effects and other things like that. So my first step is always, lately it's more sculptural because I like creating 3D sculptures using things like ZBrush, where I actually sketch out 3D models of things, and that's usually the starting point. I like to create some kind of object that I'm going to be observing. I like to mess around with a lot of geometry, a lot of symmetry and things like that, but that's usually the first step. The biggest thing here though is that the next step, I like to set up limitations and kind of, I say define variables because that's kind of how I think about it as far as a code manner goes, but like what it is that if you don't set up limitations with 3D software like that, you have such vast amount of things you can do that if you don't set these limitations for yourself, you kind of could end up making a full movie of some kind, and I like to kind of define boundaries before I start going. And that's the next step, is that I need to know what environment is this in? Is this in some kind of room? Is this in a sphere? Is this in a vast void of things? And then I usually like to add in scripts for movements and physics, and I use things like Espresso with node-based physics in Cinema 4D and simple scripts and expressions and things like that inside of After Effects to create movement. So I don't like sitting here and telling this sphere to go here and this to go there. I like to set a bunch of rules up, and then the last step is documenting that process. And so I take virtual cameras and I move them around an environment, and I like to usually take multiple takes, and usually if you look at my hard drives, I usually have about five different versions of everything I animate. And so I really like setting up these rules, and it kind of comes from my background in coding, but it's really in a non-traditional way, and so maybe that gets people inspired or gets people thinking a different way about that. That's just kind of how I approach my animations. So I also use symmetry a lot, and I kind of want to quote Del Toro here, who's one of my favorite directors and is a huge influence on a lot of the character creation I do. I have a background in a lot of traditional animation as well when I was in school, in character creation and character analysis and stuff, and he talks about how you can often break down the human face into very simple forms, and how our mind learns to recognize these forms, and you start to recognize shapes and faces and figures out of ordinary small details. And so I use symmetry a lot because I like hearing and feeling what other people see out of this. Like they tell me, oh, I see so many different things out of this, or I see this face. And I kind of like that idea that we just naturally start to form faces or ideas out of these kind of animations, and that's really exciting to me. Really quick, more current stuff that I'm doing. Teaching Machine is an audiovisual collective and production company out of LA, run by David Wexler, who is also known as Strange Loop. We're about, I don't know how many people now, a pretty big list, but we're artists, filmmakers, coders, audio musicians, all sorts of different things. And we kind of had our hands in a lot of different live shows of electronic artists and things like that you might not know about. Some big ones would be my friend Gavin and David worked on Erica Badu's tour visuals, doing things with MaxMSP and processing, doing generative visuals, and some mixing with some traditional animation as well. Things like Flying Lotus's Layer 3 show is done by John and David, and this was a more recent show that's been touring. But this is all under the Teeple Machine moniker. And one of the first projects I worked on was a kickstarted short film that was an animated short film and gallery showing and net narrative called Amnesia. And what I mostly do for Teeple Machine is the digital sculpting aspect. I kind of help take a lot of these crazy, crazy drawings and sketches that these artists give me, and I help bring them into 3D for them, and so other people can animate them. It's kind of like what you would see from like a game designer or a character designer for movies and things like that, but we're kind of doing it in a non-traditional manner. So it was a full gallery showing with a bunch of art from the from the actual film, as well as we had concept art from a lot of the characters and things like that. So what I did was I took these insane drawings that Mike and Nelson did and had to bring them into life in 3D. So I do a lot of weird creatures and sculpting and things like that. So most of these start as a sphere and then I build off of them. It's kind of like digital clay if you want to have an idea.
You shut off your mic.
Is there a
problem? I have no idea.
It says it's on. Oh, it's out of batteries. I'll just talk about it. So these are just some crazy creatures I was kind of charged with bringing into 3D so David can animate them. And this was kind of a weird project for me. I hadn't really been doing this much. It was more of a hobby for me doing this kind of 3D sculpting stuff. And so now it's kind of becoming what people are hiring me for. So it's really interesting for me. It's very new. It's something I'm not really used to, but I really love it. And I find it kind of like sketching and drawing. And it's a really cool app. It's really cool to see stuff that I build in 3D and having someone else animate it and bring it into these surreal animations. So the next project I worked on doing these models was we were kind of commissioned, Strange Loop and Scott Pagano and myself were commissioned to do Wolfgang Garner's Hounds of Hell tour, which was he's kind of a electro house live DJ that plays this huge amphitheater full of people, but he wanted this really gothic, futuristic wolfscape kind of thing, and so there's some animation scenes there as well as the models that I built for this live show. And a lot of what Teaching Machine does is a lot of stage production and a lot of behind the scenes work for a lot of these electronic artists, and it's kind of cool because a lot of the stuff I see on these tours we've had our hands in, and most people, we just don't advertise it as much, I guess. And so it's kind of exciting to see a lot of our stuff that I've done on these pictures, on these websites, you know, that I didn't even see in person myself. Thank you very much. These were just some more models from some of the stuff I had to create. Thankfully, I have people like David who has an insane imagination for creatures and things like that that he wants me to create. These were just some random things I created for that. So I'm trying to keep this going a little bit short here, but the biggest thing of what I'm working on now is a project for Riot, who you saw that video for earlier. And this is a project with Kate Wallace, who's doing choreography with dancers, and Riot, who is the centerpiece, who is a musician and live performer, and myself and Daito Manabe from Japan doing a lot of the visual aspects of it. So Daito is building sensors for Christina's body, which will be on her fingers and her motion in her body. We haven't really figured out exactly where it's gonna be yet, but we wanna do individual fingers, so when she's performing music, that will send me data to project visuals on her as well as on the dancers. So it's pretty exciting. We're meeting and having a conference call with the LA Art Museum tomorrow, which will be really exciting. Hopefully there's a lot of people interested in kind of funding this aspect of it, which is really cool. There's gonna be a whole costume designer involved. This is Christina's outfit that is, I think you guys might be the first one seeing this. I don't know if this has been publicly shown yet. But yeah, it's gonna be pretty crazy. So that's kind of what we're working on right now. And I'm also getting really excited about future projects that I want to do. And I come from a background, I'm a really nerdy person, so I really like video games and that kind of stuff. So I'm really excited about getting into game engines like Unity and the Unreal Engine that just became kind of more affordable for people. And I'm really excited about taking this knowledge of 3D that I have and building it in more an interactive environment so people can play with this kind of stuff. I've seen people do some really exciting things with Unity in a non-game manner, which has got me really excited. I'm a lot more excited about real-time visuals now that there's things like 3.js and WebGL, which this gentleman over here has got me really excited about. And this stuff the idea that this really complex 3D stuff happening in a browser just wasn't around when I was learning 3D, and so it is just blowing my mind right now that you can get these things that I'm making in a software, but in your browser in real time, very fast, and on your phone, and all over the place. I think that's just awesome. I'm also having a big resurgence of wanting to physically have objects and have art that people can hold. And I've messed around with 3D printing a bit. My good friend worked for Shapeways, so I have a few 3D prints through them that actually are only in possession of my brother in Chicago. But I'm really excited about taking a lot more of this 3D stuff that I've been making and physically printing it. I haven't really figured out what I want to do, but I want to collaborate with people a lot more as well. I'm also very excited with the gaming aspect, the game engines, involving the new Kinect as well as the Oculus Rift, which have me super excited right now. And I kind of want to get my hands on some of the development kits for that stuff. Yeah, and the last thing, more collaboration. I have met some amazing people moving to this city, and there's some awesome ideas floating around that I really want to do more of and kind of dive into. So that's kind of it for me. I added that website at the end because everyone else put their website up here and I forgot it. So if you guys have any questions, I would love to talk to you. Otherwise, if you want to just nerd out with me later, you can do that after as well. So.